My guest today has been involved in representing Celtic supporters for many, many years now. He is now involved with Fans Against Criminalisation. Eddie Toner, how are you, sir?
I'm fantastic, Billy. Much better for unravelling the mystery that is Billy Noel and getting to meet a great man. So, yeah, doing very well.
Well, thank you very much. So, what was life like for you growing up?
Life for me growing up, Billy, was pretty good, I have to say. I grew up in the sprawling housing estate that is Easterhouse in Glasgow's East End. Very happy upbringing. Lived up there with my mother, my father, one of four kids. I had an older sister, Marie. There was myself, my younger brother, Shuggy, or for folk that's listening to this, Sinn Féin Shuggy, as he was affectionately known by the teachers at St Leonard's School for some time, and my younger sister, Eileen. Life was tough in Easterhouse, like it was probably in many other housing estates around about Glasgow at the time. But it was happy, you know, we were a happy family, four of us living there together in a wee two-bedroom flat, you know, and never knew my man daddy have a bedroom. He was about 19 and we moved to Denison, so he lived in the old pull-down bed in the couch in the living room. Me and my brother shared the room, two sisters shared the room. Had a great upbringing. Schooling was great in Easterhouse, went to St Benedict's School, primary school up there, followed on to St Leonard's Secondary. That gave us a good grounding for life, I think. But Easterhouse was great. It's quite simple in these days because it was a place where basically you went to school, you came in for school, you went out and played football. There was tons of football parks in Easterhouse, there was tons of open spaces, and everybody was in the same boat. None of us had much, but yeah, we all seemed relatively happy. If I was to choose my childhood again, I don't think there would be anything I would choose any differently about it. I was, you know, perfectly happy growing up, despite us all being cramped in a wee house. But we moved down to Denison when I was 18 into this house, upstairs and downstairs and two toilets, and my man and dad eventually got a room with three bedrooms, and that was good as well. But you know, that took me off into adulthood, and it was near the town as well, which was great at 18, you know, when you move down there and you're starting to venture out up with dancing and stuff like that, you'd no fart to stagger home. So no complaints at all about my childhood, I have to say. I was very happy.
Excellent. So your first song, what would that be and why did you pick it?
My first song really takes me back to my childhood. We were a family who all like partying together. I came from a very big family. My father was one of 10, my mum was one of 6, and also was one of an extended family. Like my ma's auntie and uncle had 16 wains, and we were all very close, more so probably in the Docherty side than we were on the Toner side. My ma was a Docherty, they were off of Shettleson, and we used to all get together, and there was always some great family parties, and you know, there was always the inevitable sing-song, and quite often the songs, you know, would start off relatively tame, but that gave me a grounding for later on. For that's where I probably started to learn my first rebel songs, if you like, because we used to get, you know, The Wearing of the Green and Irish Soldier Laddie and Sean South of Gary Owen and Hail Glory St. Pat. They were the tunes. But I'm not starting off in that vein. I'm starting off with some songs that I remember me my childhood, and anybody that's ever been to a Toner or sort of a Docherty party will know this song very well. My dad, incidentally, was a cracking singer, and was a big Mark Monroe fan, and you know, loved singing Mark Monroe, Perry Como type songs. But my ma always sang this particular song, and she still does to this day. My ma's 78 now, and a season ticket holder still at Celtic Park, that's beside me in the main stand, and this is her party piece, so it just reminds me of my childhood. But it also reminds me of the New Year just passed when she was up in the house as well, and it's just one of these songs that's my ma's song, and it's Blueberry Hill by Fats Domino.
That was Blueberry Hill by Fats Domino. Right, Eddie, can you tell us a bit more about what you do?
Sort of a professionally, what I do now is I drive a black taxi for my sins around about Glasgow. I've finally succumbed and joined the petty bourgeoisie and become a self-employed taxi driver. I mean, I left school at 16 and worked in various jobs, but mostly in the public sector. I mean, I worked for a long, long time in the civil service, Her Majesty's Civil Service, working in the social security offices in Steps Road and in the city centre in the town. But eventually became sort of a gamekeeper turned poacher, went over to the other side, the real side, and became a claimants representative, and I worked in sort of welfare rights for a number of years. Started off in that line working in a community-based advice project in Hag Hill in the East End, basically advising people on their benefits and their debt problems and representing people at, you know, social security appeal tribunals and stuff like that. left Hag Hill, went on to work in Shettleston. So I've never really ventured far out the east end of Glasgow. I mean, I've lived there all my life and effectively worked there all my life, and I don't really see myself going anywhere else now. I worked in Shettleston in the Housing Association there as a welfare rights officer there for a number of years as well, and eventually left there. I had some health problems that meant I wasn't at work as quite as often as I should have been for maybe about seven, eight years ago. I was struggling a wee bit to keep the job going, and the association herself needed to keep the service going, and so I was eventually sort of offered a package to leave there, and took that, and found myself in a position when for the first time ever that I was out of work, and I was only sick for about 6-7 months, and wasn't sure where I was going to go, and sort of I stumbled into the taxi game, to be honest, because I had a couple of mates who drove taxis, and I was saying, oh, it's, you know, the money's no bad, you should try it, and I eventually did. I went and sat the knowledge or the test for the Glasgow taxis and got my taxi badge and worked for a couple of years driving for a guy, sort of feeling my way around about the job, and sort of eventually 4 years ago made the decision to sort of invest in buying a taxi, buying the plate and the car, and sort of effectively buying the business. So I'd done that 4 years ago, and I'm still doing it yet, and my timing was impeccable, like anything I've done, and you know, I was the type of guy who bought into the taxi business just when the arse fell out of it, you know. But I quite enjoy it, you know. It's different from anything I've ever done before. Quite long hours, you know, but you, in some ways you're the sort of a master of your own destiny in terms of the hours that you work and when you work, and you don't need to apply for time off, and that's much easier if you're going to see the Celtic and stuff like that. Yeah. You know, you can sort of take days off here and days off there as it pleases you, and so I like the flexibility and the freedom it offers you. I like meeting people, I like talking about Glasgow. I'm a proud Glaswegian, and you know, I like showing the city off to tourists and stuff like that, so I quite enjoy it. So that's a sort of a summary where I am professionally, but more importantly, you know, things I'm involved in at the moment, and it also seems to be things that I've been involved in all my days, is on the Celtic side of things. I mean, I've effectively been involved in Celtic supporters organisations since, it feels as if since I was born, you know. I've been a member of the Supporters Association since I was 16, member of the Denison number one supporters club. I joined that when I was 18 when I moved to Denison. I'm still a member of that. I ran the club for the best part of 20 odd years. Was involved in the Supporters Association. Was a general secretary association for 7 years, and that was very interesting. There was lots of interesting things happened in my time as a secretary association, and at that time the association were probably encroaching, you know, upwards of 7,000-8,000 members. You know, they were a big organisation with maybe 300 supporters clubs all around the world, and it was quite a daunting task, you know, doing that on a voluntary basis whilst holding down a job, and also at that time I had two young kids, my two boys who are up now, they're 20 and 18 now, but it took up a lot of my time. Eventually stepped back for the association, certainly in a committee sense, about 6-7 years ago, but was involved in a lot of campaigns during that time. You know, one of the proudest moments for me during that phase was being asked to go out to FIFA headquarters and receive the Fair Play Trophy for the Celtic fans after they were awarded it following Seville run in 1983. That was an incredible time for me. You know, I flew out there for 3 days with Peter Lawwell. You know, it was basically the World Player Awards, and you turned up at this award ceremony, you know, and it was just full of, you know, celebrities and a who's who in the football world. Yeah. You know, started off on the first night sitting having brandies with guys like Sepp Blatter and the head of the Brazilian FA and the head of the German FA, and it's a bit disconcerting as well when you see the amount of cash it was spent on these things and the level of sort of a kowtowing to people like Blatter and stuff like that, and they were all sitting there drinking brandy out of bowls I could have had a bath in, you know, and and smoking the biggest cigars in the world, you know, and, you know, it was a bit obscene in that regard, but it was proud for me in the fact that I knew I was there representing something that we as Celtic supporters had achieved. Mm-hmm. And it was recognised worldwide. But I mean, if you indulge me, there's a couple of funny stories about that I could tell, you know. I mean, one of the first things is we flew from Glasgow to London, and then we're flown for London first class with Swiss Air on to Basel in Switzerland. The flight out, the baggage handlers at Heathrow somehow contrived to lose my suit. I turned up in Basel in Switzerland, you know, chauffeur driven, picked up, you know, at the airport, myself and Peter Lawwell, and we're taken to this big fancy 5-star hotel, and all I had was the clothes I was donning in. When I arrived there, I was assured that that wasn't going to be a problem. The ceremony itself wasn't the next day, and I was told they would get the suit and fly out for me for the next day, So I was left that night in a pair of jeans and the shirt that I travelled in, and got to meet, as I say, all these celebrities and stuff like that who were all suited and booted. I mean, that in itself didn't bother me, but I was a wee bit uncomfortable about what was going to happen the next day. Anyway, I get up the next day, still no suit, And I was talking to the guy, I think at the time was David Will, who was a Scottish sort of a representative in FIFA at the time, and explaining the story to him, and he says, oh, we'll sort something out for you. And before I knew it, this guy came over and introduced himself as my driver, and he was going to take me downtown to buy a suit. So I was driven downtown to downtown Basel, and this guy was taking me around all these shops, you know, pick a suit, you know, but he's taking me into all these designer shops that had sort of a Hugo Boss suits at $4,000 and $5,000 and all these fancy, and I'm looking at myself saying, who's paying for this, you know? And when eventually I asked the guy, he says, oh, I have been instructed to buy you whatever you need, you know? So I'm looking thinking, no, I can't buy a suit. I just couldn't justify that level of expense, if you like, for one ceremony. But anyway, started trying suits on, and me being a rather portly figure, you know, it was really difficult to get a off-the-peg suit at such short notice. And eventually got this suit, and the guy saying, I can adjust that for you, no problem, you know, and I, but it was a crazy sum of money, you know, and he then explained to me that they wouldn't be able to do the alterations right away, but this is an hour or two before we're supposed to go to this ceremony, and I'd need to come back later that afternoon. So it turned out, wasn't it looking likely I was going to get a suit. I decided that, well, I'm a fans representative, I'm here representing the punters, so I'll just go to the ceremony dressed like a punter, and I'll just go as I was. And I duly did. And to be honest, I got a bit of a kicking after it on the chat rooms, if you like, for the Celtic supporters, you know, turning up representing us like a tramp, you know. And that's how these things develop, you know. So people, without realising the full story, immediately jump in, and they're just willing to give you a bit of... There was other people saying, no, he turned up there like a supporter, and there wasn't a problem with it. But this, you know, there was a debate ensued for about 3 or 4 days on the internet because I turned up there through no fault of my own, you know, dressed in the same clothes. I was starting to smell a bit, you know. And had to go after that ceremony to a match that night as well. It was a Ronaldo select against a Zidane select. And all the top players it was in the world were playing in, and it was for UNICEF, I think, that we were being wined and dined with all the foot, and I'm still sticking about with the same clothes on, but I didn't have much choice. But an even funnier story for that trip, and I'm sure this one the listeners might enjoy, was when I turned up at the ceremony, the guy was looking at me, you know, I had my accreditation, but he was clearly looking at the way I was dressed, and I had to convince him that I was, you know, Mr. Toner for the Celtic Supporters Association. After a bit of sort of a debate, you know, he agreed to let me in. And Peter Lowell, because he wasn't receiving the award, was sitting further back. I was, as a recipient, was sitting in the front row. And the guy says to me, if you go to the front, you'll find that your name is on a seat. And I, again, you know, tend to take these things in my stride. And he says, you just sit there and somebody will come over and explain. So anyway, he goes down and here's this row of seats at the front. And the names were Henri, Ronaldo, Zidane, Toner. And Lundberg was the seat next to me. So I'm thinking, oh, pretty exalted company here, Eddie boy, you know. So, you know, in troops, Zinedine Zidane and Ronaldo, the Brazilian Ronaldo, no Cristiano, the Brazilian Ronaldo. And I could see them sort of looking at me and sitting there with the same shirt and the like on, you know. But anyway, again, you know, I've never faced with celebrity, I have to say, so that wasn't bothering me, you know, but this woman came in and sat in the seat next to me, and me being me and having to get involved, sort of, I thought she was in the wrong seat, and says, excuse me, I think you're in the wrong seat. And she looked at me, and she says, oh, I don't understand. So I asked her to stand up and pointed out that the seat was Lundberg. I says, that's for Freddie Lundberg. And she laughed and says, my name is Hannah Lundberg. She says, and I'm a nominee for the best female footballer in the world. And I says, well, I beg your pardon. Good luck with the nomination. here was me thinking it was for Freddie Lundberg, and I was telling this woman she'd need to move. It turns out she didn't win the award. I think the award went to a German woman, but rather than a Swede. But I was suitably embarrassed and very apologetic. But it, you know, that was great. Some sort of great stories of my time over even just that couple of days. There was lots of other things involved in, you know, again, one of the things I'm really proud about is I chaired the committee that did all the fundraising for the Brother Wilfred statue at Celtic Park. And it was one of the first times where we were able to get all the supporters groups to pull together and work together and to a common purpose, you know. Right. Sometimes you get involved in these things in the politics or the people are pursuing their own agendas, and that always annoyed me. I was always a big and still am of the belief that if you could unite the Celtic supporters, we would be a formidable force. And sometimes we're often fragmented, and there, sometimes I think there are too many groups pursuing different interests and different agendas. And but being about the Wilfred statue is the one time where we did all work together, the representatives for the association, the affiliation and the trust, and you know, all the different groups were involved in it. And very early on in that, I mean, the idea for us with the Wilfred thing was is that we wanted to put up a memorial outside Parkhead that would serve as a permanent reminder to people about exactly who Celtic were, what we were all about, where we come from. And something that, you know, anybody walking in that front door would have a look at and say, you know, that's who we are and that's what we're all about. And that, for us, was the purpose of getting together and embarking down the road, you know, a statue. There was a lot of discussion about should we have statues of the Celtic greats first, or, you know, and for me, that just was a non-argument. For me, it could only be Wilfred. And in some ways, and, you know, and I know that's maybe a bit controversial, and some people will not agree with me, which is fine, but I don't think there should be any other statues at the front door at Celtic Park other than the brother Wilfred. I'm quite happy that statues of Jock Stein and me, Jimmy, and others have come along were placed along the ground, but I think it takes away a wee bit for the Wilfred story, having it surrounded, you know.
Yeah.
You know, if you put any mare up there, it's going to look like the Coliseum, you know. But I think, you know, maybe, you know, with this new Celtic walkway and all this stuff, maybe the statue should have been in different places. But know that they get, you know, like B. Jimmy and Big Jock were, you know, one of the great Celts or great servants to the club or anything like that. But I just felt that Wilfred himself should stand out like a beacon. Not only is a reminder of to us, see where we come from, but as a reminder for future generations. But but anyway, the statue's there, and very early on in the campaign, there was a couple of prominent businessmen, if you like, come to us and says, what's it going to cost? We'll throw the money in, we'll get it up. And we didn't want that either. What we wanted was to raise the money. We wanted the Celtic supporters to raise the money. Again, part of an educational process, if you like. It was, you know, if one guy was throwing a pound in a bucket for that statue, he was thinking about why he was putting a pound in a bucket. The statue eventually cost us, I think, somewhere in the region of about £60,000-£65,000, and it took us about 3 years to raise the money. Through different fundraisers, supporters, clubs were chipping in. We organised a few big do's at Celtic Park to raise funds. We had a bucket collection. We'd all that, but it was important for us that every Celtic supporter get the opportunity to donate to it rather than somebody signing off a cheque for it. We could have put it up in a week, but it took us 3 years. But the fans paid for it. And it's there. And, you know, I remember the day of the unveiling of it. Thousands turned up at Celtic Park for the unveiling and made a big fancy ceremony and stuff like that. And, you know, and that was a really proud moment for me as well. And it's something I can look back and say, well, you know, that's something that, you know, I was involved in, and it helped the Celtic supporters to achieve. And things like that. I've always been in, you know, round about Celtic. I've always been involved in projects that for me are important, because for me, Celtic are about the supporters. You know, the players come, players go, chief execs come, chief board members come, you know, but the fans are the only constant at the club. And we are what defines Celtic for me. It's a community for me. That's what draws me to Celtic every week. I don't go to Celtic in an expectation that we're going to win. And in some ways, for me, that's not the most important thing. And I know it is for some, and I'm quite, you know, if people attach themselves to the club because they just see it as a release, and, you know, a sporting release, and they just, you know, and they want success, and that's good. But it was never about that for me. For me, Celtic are about the community and the people at Foley Room, and the, you know, my family and your family and all the other Celtic families that all come together and, you know, as a community. And for me, that's really what defines Celtic, and that's what will always define Celtic for me. So I used to say to boys in the bus when they got upset after we'd lost big games, and you know, we didn't win the day, but for me, the victory for us as Celtic supporters was, you know, looking around the stadium, watching the crowds that were there, and when, you know, when that team ran onto the park every week, that was a victory for me, because there was so many obstacles put in the way of Celtic and Celtic success, and we overcome that time after time after time. And that in itself is a victory for me. And being part of that community is what makes Celtic special. So, suppose on a personal point, that's really what defines me. People probably know me first and foremost as Eddie Toner, a Celtic fan, rather than Eddie Toner, the taxi driver, or the welfare rights officer, or I've done in a professional capacity. So, I probably always will be associated with Celtic in that regard. You know, it's nothing I'm ashamed of. I'm actually something I'm quite proud of. So,
your second song, what would that be?
My second song. And again, it takes me back to to my early days up in Easterhouse. I mean, I was never a big out there music fan. You know, when I grew up, it was, you know, as I said earlier, it was all about supporting Celtic, and I was just immersed in football. So my music was probably defined by Top of the Pops, and you know, I was, you know, I influenced with what was on Top of the Pops at the time, and if I liked a song, some of my musical tastes all over the place, as you'll probably realise when we get to the end of this. You know, there's no a constant in it, and you know, if I liked a song, I liked a song, and been Top of the Pops when I was growing up was a big thing. We all sat and we watched Top of the Pops, and you know, on a Thursday night when it came on, and we listened to the charts. We were all tape recorders, so they taped the charts and stuff like that, and played that back all weekend. So I was a big Slade fan in 80s. I loved all the stuff that Slade done, you know, for, you know, Mama, we're all crazy now, you come and feel the noise and stuff like that. So I probably couldn't have done a session like this without mentioning Slade, but this particular song, I think personally for me, was Slade's best song. I don't think it ever reached number one, actually, for me it was, it's just a song I always reflect back to in my very young days in Easterhouse and my Top of the Pops days. And I remember buying a few different Slade albums and stuff like that, and this was one I used to play all the time. So it's Far Far Away by Slade.
That was Far Far Away by Slade. Who were your heroes and influences?
I've been thinking about this question the last week or so, and in terms of influences, like probably a few of your other guests, I mean, the obvious ones are their political influences, you know, people like Mandela. For anybody growing up when I did, you couldn't help being influenced with people like Bobby Sands and the hunger strikers and the sacrifices that people like that made. A political sense, people like Tony Benn influenced me, Dennis Skinner, you know, traditional Labour Party people, you know, throughout the 70s and 80s. Ultimately, I think the biggest influences in me have been my family. I come from a very big family, but although we're a big family, we're not a far-flung family. We were all, none of us have ventured far out of the East End. And my father was a big influence in me growing up. My dad, like probably many of that generation, was a hard-working guy. He worked in the building game all his days, and he liked his pint, and he liked his punt. He was a bit of a punter. You know, he probably worked hard and played hard and loved going to see the Celtic and stuff like that. And you know, he was a big influence in my life. Sadly, I lost my dad in 1998. He died of lung cancer when he was only 63. And I still miss him. My dad became probably more of a mate than a father. You know, we used to go for a pint together and went to the odd game together and stuff like that. And so he was a big influence in the family, you know, and his loss was a terrible loss. But probably my mother was more of an influence. My ma kept the family going, you know. My ma had a part-time job, and she probably needed to work. She didn't, like, most days, none of us work because we love it. We all work out of necessity. So my ma kept, you know, the house going and the family going while my dad was working. And quite often, you know, there were times when my dad would be working maybe away from home and stuff like that, and the money would come back, and my ma probably get her set wages, and my dad is few bob for his punting and his pint. And my ma just got on with things, make things happen. But even for a Celtic supporting sense, my ma was a big influence in me. My grandfather, my mum's dad, was a groundsman at Celtic Park for the best part of 30 years. Mm-hmm. So we were always doing one about the park. We all hung about there when we were kids, and you know, and that was the time of the 60s, you know, in the 70s when, you know, Jock Stein was around. And Jock Stein was a great pal of my grandad's, and used to come and visit us. And my granny and grand eventually moved into the flats at Parkhead, and Big Jock would quite often drive in for a cup of tea and stuff like that. Yeah. And it was just incredible, you know, thinking back on it. But the Celtic thing was really, we were steeped in Celtic because I think Mary Mama's influence. I could have went to, my dad went to all the games as well. I could have went with my dad to matches. I went to my dad with matches at Menston and outside the pub in Shettleston to, like, you know, 10-3, and then having to run, like, you know, Jesus down the road to make sure you go there for the kickoff. But you were left stunned outside with your bottle of Coke and your packet of plain crisps. The other side of that was I could have went with my ma and or a sister and all my aunties and that all worked in the pie stalls, right, at the game. So they were always doing early, getting the stalls set up and that. So I kind of went with my man. It meant you get in for nothing. Well, you get in for nothing anyway if you went with your dad because you get a lift there. But I went down with my ma because you went down early and you get in and you get a seat in the main stand, and quite often you would have been the first person sitting in the stadium, you know, and you could see the stadium building up. And And I hark back to the big European nights and stuff like that. It was just amazing as a wee boy, you know, going to, like, you know, the Inter Milan game, you know, when me Dixie put the boy at the bar, and, you know, Fiorentina, Juventus, Doza, you know, Basel, all the games, big nights at Celtic Park, being in there right at the start and watching the grun and, you know, listening to the atmosphere build up and stuff like that. And, you know, I was hooked then for that, so... Right. So in a Celtic supporting sense, my ma was a big influence. I remember a great story as well, he going to the Leeds United European Cup semi-final, and again I had the choice of going with my dad when the bus for, what was it, I think McMullins and Shittleson or the Town Tavern or snowing, or going with my ma and my granny, God rest her, and my auntie Mary, God rest her. Yeah. I need tickets for a big North Stand at Hampden Hill North Stand, or I could went with my dad into the cell end, I thought, and even at 7 years of age I was quite wise, you know. So I think I'll go with my man, my granny and my auntie Mary, you know. So we went to Hampden, and I'll never forget that night, being in the North Stand and looking down just at the sheer volume of the crowd, and the game itself was obviously incredible. I don't remember much about the actual football that was played, but, you know, I was aware that Celtic had won, you know, and I knew that was us in the final European Cup again, and it was just incredible. But we get lost coming out. I remember my dad saying, when you come out, you know, turn left and keep walking and that'll bring you into the town. My plan was to walk to the town and get a train back to Easterhouse. But we, for some reason, turned right and ended up in Castlemilk, you know. So when we get lost, that was my biggest memory of that night. You know, Celtic had just won a European Cup and we were stoating about Castlemilk. Like, you know. It was for a boy, Feasterhouse was quite daunting, you know. We were over there in enemy territory. No apologies to any people out there. I'm sure the parrot will kill me for that. But Castlemilk was a strange place for us in the days. You know, it's probably the first time I'd ever been that far south. So my ma took me to all the big games. And my ma still goes to Celtic Park to this day. My ma's a season ticket holder at Celtic. She sits in the main stand in the same row as me and my sister and a couple of her pals. And so it's still a big family thing for us. So, but even just in a sense, you know, my ma, family being important and keeping things going and how she looked after us all as kids and stuff like that, I would say my ma was probably a big influence in a personal capacity. In terms of heroes, again, I've got the obvious political heroes, as I said earlier, but I worked in sort of a public service also, you know, as I made mention earlier. I worked in community-based projects and I worked in housing associations and stuff like that. And for me, people I look back on in heroes are people that came from the communities like Shettleson and like Hag Hill and places in the East End, with a number of people who came out as volunteers and worked. You know, these were people who had nothing in tough estates and tough communities, but gave freely at their own time to try and make life better for others round about them. And the number of times they would be out at meetings or they'd be out campaigning for this or campaigning for that. My time at Hag Hill, we were instrumental and helped to set up with my colleague Alison. We were instrumental in setting up things like a credit union, furniture recycling project, a community cafe, getting funding for community halls and we did that as workers. We were paid workers and we helped to facilitate, you know, what was going on with the committees there, if you like. But the people who turned up in the committees and made a real difference to the communities were heroes to me, if you like. They'll never be big names and they never did it for the, you know, the publicity or the glory. But for me, they were real heroes. And there's probably countless people like that up and down the country, and real working class heroes, if you like. And I look back in eight people, I'm not going to mention them because they would be embarrassed, I think, if I was to put their name out there publicly. But people like that were heroes to me rather than celebrity, if you like. And you know, and it probably still goes on to this day, and they make a real difference in our communities. And for that reason, they were my heroes.
Fantastic. A third song, what would that be?
My third song, and again, taking you back to my Top of the Pops days, and I could never do a thing like this without Rod the Mod. We were all big Rod Stewart fans in our house. When I'm talking about my brother and my two sisters, and not so much my wee sister, because she was 6 years after I was born. But me and my sister and my brother, 3 years were born in less than a space of 3 years, you know. And so we were all grew up together, and we used to buy LPs and put their initials on them, Marie Eddie and Shug and stuff like that. And Rod Stewart, again, influenced, you know, was always prominent. We were all big Rod Stewart fans, and I loved the sort of rock and roll sound and all that sort of stuff about Rod Stewart, and always have done. So I couldn't do a session like this without, again, making some reference to Rod, and thought, you know, would it be Reason to Believe? Would it be, you know, something for the Atlantic Crossing? It was a bit more soppy album and stuff like that. But I went for You Wear It Well, because it's still a song I love, and I've got a wee drink and sort of a belt in it and sort of a dancing in the living room. So, Rod Stewart, You Wear It Well.
Fantastic. So, Eddie, what are your earliest memories of going to Celtic Park?
To be perfectly honest, I can never remember no going about Celtic Park or no being about the park. I mean, you know, as I said, my granddad at the time when I was born was a groundsman at Celtic Park, and I just always seemed to be about the park. My ma would take me down there, you know, in my pram, probably down to see her dad, down to day. The family all worked around about the park in various, you know, activities. They worked in the pie stalls. My granny was a cleaner. My granny used to polish the trophies, you know. She had the privilege of polishing the European Cup and stuff like that. And I myself was born in Belvedere Hospital, which, you know, is only a corner kick away from Celtic Park and London Road. So I feel as if I was practically born in Celtic Park, you know. And I can't really remember a time when I've known been about the park. But in terms of going to a game, my young sister Eileen was born in 1969, and at the time, due to the overspill and the maternities and stuff like that, she was born in a place called Calder Bank House, I think it was, out in Bayliston. We stayed in Easterhouse at the time, and my ma was in there. August 69, she was born, and I remember us being to visit my ma in the hospital, I think the morning of the game, and then we were taking the parkade with my dad in the afternoon. So around about the time she was born, August 1969, we all went along, and I can remember, I'm pretty sure we were playing Raith Rovers and won 5 or 6-0. So that would probably be my earliest memory of being at a game. You remember the big games, you know. I remember the, you know, again, referenced earlier, the European Cup semi-final, Leeds, and, you know, the great semi-final with Inter Milan, and the semi-final with Atletico Madrid. And brought up as a boy in 8 times, just incredible, you know. You were getting to the last 8, the last 4, or the final of the European Cup on a regular basis. And, you know, anybody that didn't get hooked in Celtic at that time, you know, there must have been something wrong with them. But I've always been about the park. I mean, probably since I was about 5 years old, I could probably count, maybe miss less than 10, 20 games at Celtic Park in all the years. I just went all the time, every week. If there was a game on, you went to the match. Started going to away games when I was very, very young age as well, you know, and went to the bus for Easterhouse. And then when we moved to Denison, I joined the Celtic Supporters Club in Denison. But I spent most of my time sort of thinking, I never really did anything. Even when I was a young adult, I never really arranged anything without thinking, well, where's Celtic playing? Everything was all based on about where the game was that weekend, or is there a game during the week? And I never made any arrangements. Like thousands of others, I just never missed games. And I was lucky, you know, we coming for East End, Celtic Park was on my doorstep, you know, and I didn't need to make the sacrifices that some people do, you know, to get to see Celtic. But I seriously can't remember a time when I didn't go to games. I mean, a wee bit of stushy at the moment. Since Christmas, I've decided I'm not travelling to any away games at the moment, because, you know, just through the way things are going at games at the moment, I've lost a bit of the enjoyment here. Yeah, and a lot of it's down to the way that the police are sort of carrying out, you know, their role and the powers that have been given through this Offensive Behaviour Act. And, you know, the amount of searching and, you know, surveillance and buses getting stopped and getting searched 3 and 4 times going into games. And then when you get into the game, it's almost like a military manoeuvre going to the football now. And it's and I've decided myself that one of the things I'm going to do is stop going to away games now, just to give myself a break for that. And I'm no advocating that people should be boycotting games. I think, you know, if we all Celtic supporters were to stop doing that to an extent for a few weeks, the people who run the clubs around about the country, Aberdeen, Dundee United, St Mirren, Kilmarnock, wherever it might be, I think, you know, the guys that run the clubs would be beating a sort of a fast path to Alex Salmond's door, saying, hold on a minute, this is starting to cost us money and we need to look at this again. And I've probably missed more games this season than I have probably in the last 20. Mm-hmm. You know, I haven't been to an away game since, I think the last away game I was at was maybe the Motherwell game before Christmas. I think maybe the Hearts Cup tie was after that, maybe. Mm-hmm. I can't remember the way the 2 games came, but, you know, I haven't been in away games since then. And, you know, it really upsets me, because I've just spent my whole life going to the football. Yeah. But it's just my envy protest. I'm not out there banging the drum saying everybody should support it. It's my envy protest at the moment. And I also should say as well, there are things going on behind the scenes at Celtic Park as well. There, I was encouraged recently when the board came out and made such a, you know, public statement, you know, opposing the bill and asking for the act and an early review of it and stuff like that. But, you know, we've really been at them for 2 years to do that, and it's only now, you know, and you wonder why it's only now. But there's a few things going on about behind the scenes that I'm not entirely happy with. And again, this will be controversial and create a big debate amongst the support, but I think the way the Green Brigade boys have been treated is an absolute disgrace. I think sometimes they've been demonised by the press in this country for, you know, just at a time when a mob across the city are on their knees and about to go, you know, every time that they're really struggling and looking to go down the stank again, it seems that somebody throws a bit of dirt at the Green Brigade and gets them on the front page and keeps the other people off. And I think sometimes, you know, the people that are running the club at the moment have indulged that to a certain extent and have been quick to demonise that group as well. And so, you know, I'm really in a real dilemma at the moment because I know the season ticket renewals will be hitting my doormat quite soon and I'm not sure what I'm doing for next season. And I never ever thought I'd say that. I'm a guy that's had a season ticket again for as long as I can remember and a guy that just goes to all the games and I'm conflicted at the moment because of the way things are going in football and it's just not the same enjoyment in it for me at the moment. I'll always be part of what Celtic are in that community and I'll always continue to sort of support the charitable aspect to that in the Celtic community, but I'm really, really conflicted at the moment about whether or not I'm going to throw my £600 into the pot and, you know, and say, well, just carry on as normal, guys. I really think something's going to happen between now and the end of the season to resolve a lot of the sort of PLC fan issues out there and this will probably generate reams of debate on Twitter and stuff like that. But that's just my opinion. But no, earliest memories, I can't remember a time when I didn't go to Parkhead and I'm really, really conflicted because I'm contemplating a time where I might not go next season. And I hope it doesn't come to that. I hope, you know, and I'm not saying they should do something just to suit Eddie Toner, but I'm hoping that there'll be some resolution to the difficulties that are there at the moment to allow me just to get back to, you know, supporting the team and enjoying my football again. So,
right, Eddie, your fourth song.
I left school in 1979, just at the time, and I don't even know why to mention her name, it's such a fun programme, but it was the time that Margaret Thatcher came to power. And I suppose around about that time is when I started becoming a bit politically aware. You know, started working the civil service and quickly get involved in the sort of trade unions in the civil service. And I made a lot of great friends through that. And there were some people at that time who influenced me as well. But, you know, throughout that sort of, you know, from 79 right through the early into the late 80s, you know, in the real tough Thatcher years. And, you know, there was what was going on in this country. You know, obviously, you know, sort of 84, you had the miners' strike and, you know, just the breakdown of communities all up and down the country, you know, they were being run down, the working class were under the attack. And I'll never forget what she did to the country, and I don't think anybody should. And also you had what was going on in Ireland at the time as well, you know, the war had really sort of increased and you had the hunger strike in 1981, and what she allowed to happen there as well was criminal. Yeah. You know, and I really do hope that, you know, she's been judged in a higher place than she ever would have been in this earth. But for the crimes that she committed against humanity, she should pay a price for that. So there was a whole Thatcher years when I was growing up and starting to sort of make my way in the world, if you like. And I'll just never forget what she did and that. And I still think we're paying the price for Thatcherism and maybe some of the things that are going on in our communities at the moment. And so this song for me defines that period. It's a song where I think you can really look at it and say, you know, it sums up what Britain was becoming under Thatcher. And it's just a song that's always, any time I hear it, I just think back to the times, you know, terrible times. And it's the song is Ghost Town by The Specials, and it, you know, serves as a reminder to people that we should never allow people like that to run our country again. Sadly, we're not that far away with people like Cameron and Clegg, but there's a whole other political debate there about where we go over the country, but this song, Ghost Town by The Specials, just sums up what Thatcher done to our communities.
Okay, so what irritates you?
Again, this is another one I've been giving some thought to. I think I've probably arrived at a time in my life where I can be described as a grumpy old man. I didn't think I'd ever get here, but this question's made me reflect on that, and I quite clearly have become a grumpy old man because I'm irritated by almost anything at the moment. I'm irritated by bad manners. And I don't mean the band, I mean actual bad manners. Wee daft things, you know, you hold the door open for somebody and they walk right through it and they don't say thanks very much. And I feel like slamming it in their curtain, you know. You know, things like that, you know, I'm irritated even in the taxi where people get in and they just sit the whole time on their mobile phone and they don't, you know, there's no please or thank you, or they issue instructions and they get out and bang the, just bad manners, you know, just things like that. I'm irritated sometimes when I go you know, maybe at restaurants and stuff like that, and you sometimes see some of the younger youns, and you know, they order up and they don't thank the waiter for putting the stuff down, and they're taking their plates away, and just common courtesy and a lackey rat at the moment. Now, I don't know if there's always been a lackey rat, maybe with the younger generation, and when I was young, we were told to say please and thank you and acknowledge. We're always told to always treat people the way you would want them to treat you, and I think that's a great mantra for going through life. And I think there's a real lack of that at the moment, and that irritates the hell out of me. What else irritates me? We could really go on all day. Smoking irritates me. I've never been a smoker, and people smoking, and even in my vicinity, irritate me. I don't know if it's because we're now living such a sort of a sanitised sort of a social scene where nobody smokes now, and you know, the very hint of it sort of really annoys me. And, you know, we can understand why folk would want a sort of a fly puff at the game and stuff like that, because it gets tense and nervous and stuff like that. But as soon as I get a whiff of that, I get annoyed, you know, because it's invading my personal space, and I need to smell it and breathe it in and stuff like that. And I feel like I'm shouting, "Pay a faggot," you know. But I don't, because I try and appreciate that a particular person might need that fight to get them to the end of the game without going nuts. The Wayans irritate me with their mobile phones, right. You know, and they're constant looking at their mobile phones, and I hate if you're having, not just with Wayans, but I hate even with adults, if you're having a conversation and they're staring at their phone, and it's almost as if, and to Facebook or tweet or, yeah, it's almost as if they would rather be talking to complete strangers, right, than listen to what you've got to say. And that annoys the life out of me, and then when I was thinking about that, I can probably recall times when I've done that as well, you know, and maybe I'm irritating to others, and I'm going to really try and no do that in the future. And if I have done it to anybody, I'll take this opportunity to apologise to them. So people throwing litter annoys me. I recall no long ago being in Shittleson Road and watching this young kid come out of shop at dinner time, you know, and all the takeaway shops and that are all packed, you know, the Wayans, you know, being sort of a healthy eaters in the East End, we're all queued up beside the chippy, or buying their rolls and sausage, or their boxes of noodles, or whatever it is. But this wee lassie came out of this shop and took a roll out of a bag and threw it in the flare. And I looked at her and I says, "Gonna pick that up." And she was about 12. And she just looked at me straight in the eye and went, "Fuck off. It's got nothing to do with you." And that more than irritated me. I think Wayans now don't appreciate the value of anything either, you know, and they get things too easy. And I'm probably starting to sound like my dad had done his dad before that. And I really worry about where we're going in the future in terms of how Wayans are going to converse, because it's all done electronically now, and it's nobody sits down and has a conversation or can chat with you about things. And so I think bad manners, a lack of common courtesy, people not being aware about what they're, you know, what's going on about them and the environment, and you know, the fact that we've all got to live together, you know, people who think it's all right just to, quite often I'm driving in a taxi, you'll see somebody in front of you in a windy going down and a whole load of fucking junk will get popped out the window, and you think, and I feel like driving after them and getting in front of them, you know, like the Sweeney, and saying, "Oh, pick it up." You know, it's a disgrace, you know. So all of that sort of stuff irritates me. What really irritates me more than anything at the moment, and again, I have to go back to it, is going to the football and coming up against overzealous stewards in polis at the games now. It's almost as if the stewards and the polis have turned themselves into a sort of a wee private army that's going to attack ordinary football fans going to the match, you know, and it's almost as if they're creating jobs for themselves, you know, where, I mean, I've been to games in the past where there's been, you know, talk about the Leeds United game and over 100,000, but, you know, I've been at Hampden for years and it's Celtic Park when there's been 60, 70, 90, thousands, and we managed to get to the games without any bother.
Aye.
In and out, relative safety. There was a big, you know, you had to wait to get in. There was a bit of a crush every now and again. But nobody was ever really seriously injured. And we all get in, and people get in with their carry outs even in the days, and get away again without too much trouble. And now we go to the football in these ultra modern stadiums where safety is paramount. And we seem to need more stewards now than ever, and more polis than we ever had. And that irritates me, because why is that? What's changed? In fact, things have changed for the better, if you like, in terms of, you know, to use company speak, spectator comfort, you know, and the fans' match day experience, you know. Oh, statements like that irritate me. You know, you're going to the game with your pals to see the Celtic, you know, it's the match day experience. That kind of irritates the life out of me. But in terms of the match day experience, things are safer now than they've ever been.
Aye.
But we seem to need an army of police and an army of stewards to look after us. That irritates me. We now need legislation to govern how we should behave at football, when in actual fact, you know, there hasn't ever really been any serious disorder at football. The last time I can remember there being a real problem at a football game in this country was the 1980 Cup final. But all of a sudden, we seem to need legislation to tell us how to behave. You know, we seem to have a government in Holyrood, the Scottish government, who seems to want to run our lives for us. You know, not just from about football, some of the other legislation they've brought in is it's all about what you can and can't do, you know. And so things like that irritate me on a much bigger scale. But the biggest irritation I have, and this is going to go on all day, and, you know, my family, it's common knowledge at parties or at anything I'm invited to, they say, don't give Eddie a mic, or don't give my dad a mic, because he never shuts up. So I'm afraid you're copping this today, Billy. But the thing that irritates me more than anything new is air travel and being able to go anywhere on a plane. And how that is almost impossible with the, you know, the security checks and having to weigh your suitcase. You know, see people storing and putting cases in bathroom scales before they go on holidays. And I mean, I used to go away when I was younger to Benidorm and Ibiza and Mallorca with all my pals, and you just threw all your clothes in a bag and you threw your carry out in a bag sometimes as well, and popped it onto the carousel, and away you went to the bar, you went to the plane, and it was all part of going away and part of the excitement. Now you've got to think about weighing cases and what can go in your bag and what can't, and where your aerosols, where your, you know, your shaving stuff goes, and again, that's almost like a military manoeuvre now as well, going on holidays. And then you get there and you're almost strip searching through the airport. Everything comes off your belt, your socks, your shoes. You know, it's just all madness. You know, and life seems to get more complicated as you get older. I don't know. You know, life seemed a lot simpler when I was younger, and we didn't have the amount of technology that we have now, and the safety procedures in place that we used to. Should be a lot easier now, but it seems to get complicated. It seems to be getting more complicated. So I'm irritated with just about anything in the valley, you know. It's just where I'm in my life. But, but no, I'm sorry, I probably no finish, but I'll leave it at that.
Write your fifth song.
My fifth song, and I just touched on it briefly there. I started going on holiday in the sort of early 80s. It was a lads abroad sort of a time, you know, when I started to branch. My first time I ever went abroad, I think it was in 1981. My first European away game was to Madrid when we played in the Bernabeu in the quarterfinals of European Cup. But I went by bus to that. First time I was ever on a plane was in 1981, and I went to Benidorm with a big group of my pals, guys I worked with in the old civil service at the time, and another mate of mine, Tammy Dunnock, who's a big Celtic supporter, Feasterhouse. And we went to Benidorm, and that was followed up a few years later with holidays, and we went to Ibiza, and we went to Mallorca, and back to Ibiza. And at that time, the sort of music scene was starting to change, you know. It was going for all the sort of a traditional rock and roll stuff to sort of a more dance type of music was being introduced at the time. And I was sort of thinking back to that period and saying, which song would I really pick for that era that sort of gives me the memories of the holidays? And, you know, and there was a number of them, you know, New Order's Blue Monday. There was, you know, a lot of songs for the sort of Band-Aid time as well, because I remember being in Mallorca at the time and that was on. But this song always stood out for me for a couple of years when we were in Ibiza. And I always thought it was a bit odd that it was a song where everybody went up to dance to, because When you're listening to the words, you know, it's quite a sad song, but it's, you know, it sort of builds up into a real sort of a lively sort of a, and it became a sort of a dancey type song. And I think, suppose, looking back as well, it became a particularly sad song given that the guy that wrote it committed suicide not long after he wrote it. But it's a song for me, it just gives me memories of that time when I was going away with all the boys and enjoying the holidays abroad. And it was a song I used to play a lot in A-Days as well. So the song is Be Joy Division, and it's Love Will Tear Us Apart.
That was Love Will Tear Us Apart by Joy Division. Right, how do you relax?
How do you relax? This is as bad as a what irritates you question, because I don't seem to be able to relax at all at the moment. I sort of almost I'm like a coiled spring the way I walk about these days. But I used to relax by going to the football. People have picked up on that. That's no longer a source of relaxation for me. Quite the opposite, in fact. It probably winds me up more than anything does at the moment. And I would love to get back to just the old days where you went to the football and you had a couple of beers and a few halves into the game, or the members of your supporters bus. We always had a great wee social scene in the supporters bus. Great sing songs coming back, and it wasn't the Celtic songs. You know, people who know the Denison number one will know that they're famed for songs like my big pal who helps to run the bus, famed for singing Living Doll, Cliff Richard songs. We used to have people singing Pet Shop Boys songs, and people just got up and sung their favourite songs. And there was a lot of the old traditional Celtic songs, and it was a great source of relaxation. It was, you went to the game and win, lose or draw, you're coming back with a sing song in the bus, and it was a sense of us all being together. And for me at the moment, that's missing. So the football is a source of relaxation, but there's a lot of things going on with us in a personal sense at the moment. We don't have a lot of time for relaxation. The families are getting big, and and they bring their own difficulties. I like to go wandering. I mean, I say wandering, I don't mean in the hills. I mean doing wee pub crawls. But I'm at a stage now where I tend to like doing that myself. And it could be on a Monday afternoon, for instance. I mean, I work at the weekends now, as I say, as it says earlier, being part of the petty bourgeoisie, there's not a lot of time after the weekend for me. You become self-employed, your social scene takes you down a different road. And I suppose as you get older as well, you're not out as much as you used to be and stuff like that. And so I tend to work quite often at the weekends. I mean, if there's something particular we've got on, as a family do, or a night out we're asked to, then I just go on. I'm not a slave to the taxi, so I take the nights off. But because I work quite often at the weekend, I've now found myself, I like going out on a Monday. And I tend to, on a Monday, just like to go a wee wander. And because there's no very much others out on a Monday, most people are working, I like to go. I get my partner Jeanette works over at Glasgow University, and quite often I'll go over and meet Jeanette at the uni and start off there, and maybe have a coffee or a wee bite tea or something at lunchtime. And then I just go and I do a wee personal pub crawl, and I don't mean I don't go out and get bloated, although if last Monday was any day, but Jeanette will tell you I do go out and get bloated, because I did last week. But I've developed a fondness over the last couple of years again for real ales. So I like to go and find pubs that serve good real ale. So, being here in the West End, I'd maybe start at places like Tennant's Bar, and then I walk through there and make my way into the town, and I maybe go down onto Argyll Street into places like the Ben Nevis, or along into the Bon Accord, pubs where it serves decent ales, and have a wee pint here and a pint there, and as you'll gather, I'm a guy that likes to talk, so I go into the pubs and I'll strike up a conversation with strangers, or I'll meet folk that I would know, bump into now and again, and I sort of make my way back towards the other end of the town, back to the righteous side of town, to the East End. So I quite often wander through the West End to the East End. I'd stop and half and have a wee pint here or a pint there. And inevitably, once I hit the East End, I'll bump into people that I know. And it could be in places like the Toll Booth, or, where I go and sometimes meet a couple of pals of mine. Or I'll arrange my oldest boy, Edward, he's studying it. Strathclyde Uni at the moment, and he usually finishes about 3 o'clock on a Monday, so I'd maybe meet him, maybe have a beer with him. He's up the road, and I'll continue my pub crawl further east, finishing up places like the Healing Jesse and the Gallagate. But I like visiting all traditional pubs. Right. Healing Jesse, for instance, doesn't have a puggy machine or a jukebox or a telly, it's just a real pub where you can get in and have a bladder. And I mean, last week, for the first time in years, I went into the... This is like an advert for the traditional pubs of Glasgow, but last week I went here to Kingston and went into the Laurison Bar, which is like stepping back into the 1970s. For empty's been in it. It's an old pub. It's still got the old Formica tables and all the old posters up and all the old drink adverts and stuff. And it sells really good real ale, and it's just a cranking pub. I just really enjoyed it. People, family run with couple of older brothers and I think a sister, just a great wee boozer, and enjoy the couple of beers in there, so that helps me relax. I just like going wandering. I like meeting people, I like talking to folk, and a few pints along the way, maybe finish it off with a couple of nice malt whiskies, and then up the road, and up the road suitably relaxed after that. But that helps me. I like, if we can find the time, me and Jeanette will go to the pictures or something like that sometimes as well, and chill out a wee bit, and but we've not had as much time recently to do it. We get caught up in a lot of the sort of a fan related stuff as well, and we really need to try and find some time to maybe try and relax a bit more, because we don't seem to do much relaxing now. But that's probably my main source of relaxation at the moment, just staying my wee regular Monday. But they're off at the moment because we're in the middle of Lent, so that. So I'm looking forward to them resuming. Although I've an exception next Monday for St Patrick's Day, so.
You're allowed that.
Right, your sixth song.
My sixth song, again, you know, takes me back to the 80s. The 80s were mad for me, you know. You know, there was a whole load of stuff went on in the 80s politically, as we've touched on, and they weren't the great times for the working class, if you like. But they were also a time for me when I was growing up. Tons of great mates, but music for me was like after you'd been at a night out or been on holiday together, and we would all pile back to somebody's house for a party, and songs would get rattled on, and you just, there were certain songs you just needed to play once you had a wee drink, and everybody jumped about to and enjoyed, and this song was one of them. I had a mate of mine, Jim Delaney, a pal for Coat Bridge, who's still a great friend, and Jim had a wee flat in Bayleson at the time, and I see a wee flat, you know, if you had half a dozen people in it, that was it more, but we could pack 20 people in it for parties, but we quite often we'd end up in Jim's house after a good night, and we would batter on auto-tunes. And one of my favourite albums at that time was New Boots and Panties, Ian Dury and the Blockheads. And just the song that I love playing. And again, because I like that rock and roll sort of a sound. And, you know, and it was just a song where you just get into the music and the beat of it and everything. I just thought it was brilliant. And it just, again, great memories of the days when we were all babied and back in Jim's flat. And the song is... Sweet Jane Vincent by Ian Dury and the Blockheads. Great song.
That was Sweet Jane Vincent by Ian Dury and the Blockheads. So, what does the future hold for you?
What does the future hold for me? I'm not sure. Self-employed, working away at the moment, hoping to be able to take my feet off the gas a wee bit. You know, the plan was is to, you know, bought into the taxi trade a few years ago, really worked hard over the last few years to try and pay all the finance off for buying the business and stuff like that. Pretty close to that. Accumulated a fair bit of other debt along the way. So I'm just looking to sort of clear the decks in terms of that. For kids, you know, my two boys, Edward and Daniel, Edward's at university, quite close to making a serious decision to get off to the seminary and maybe going to study in Rome next year for the priesthood. And, you know, that gives me a lot of pride. And I think that itself might need a bit of, you know, hopefully he'll need a bit of support, and we'll be able to give that to him as he goes through his studies towards that. My younger boy, Daniel's should have been at university last year, was offered a place away from home, decided he felt he was too young to go away, so he's reapplied for uni this year, so hopefully he'll be embarking on his university careers quite soon, and I'm hoping to be able to support him through that as much as I possibly can. Two other kids, Jeanette's two kids, my stepkids, if you like, Kevin and Sophia. Kevin's just left school now and sort of trying to get out and find his way in the world, and Sophia's still at school. But, you know, the immediate future is about seeing the kids up and away and hoping that they go off and find their way in the world and be everything they can be, and, you know, and try to be there for them just as much as possible. But one of the things I need to stop trying to do is run their lives for them, you know. I need to try and step back for that, and, you know, they need to be allowed to grow up themselves and find their way in the world. But I'm an awful guy for thinking that I can fix things, I mean, maybe I can, or I can influence that, and you ask what irritates me, and that probably irritates them, but it's just because I care for them, and I hope that, you know, they find their way in the world. I've no expectations that they're all going to be millionaires or, you know, famous. I just want them all to be happy, and I want all the ones to grow up and just be as good as they can be and to contribute to the world. And even if it's, you know, I spoke earlier about working class heroes and people who make a real difference to their communities, and I was genuine about it. They are my heroes. Mm-hmm. I think that's what goes on in the book. And I'd like to see my kids sort of going off and being everything they can be, and if I can support them doing that's the immediate future. I'm hoping, you know, in the not too far off future, that, you know, they'll be away doing that, and that gives us a bit of time then to start having time for us again, you know, and being able to sort of relax a bit more and you know, find more ways of relaxing and seeing a bit of the world. And I'd love a time for us, you know, for myself and Jeanette again, just to be back to, well, where's the Celtic playing this weekend? Let's get away for the weekend and, you know, no worry about having to come back for this, that, or the next thing. And, or they're Celtic playing away in Europe, you know, let's go for 3 or 4 days and just do our own thing. And supposing a personal point of view, you know, there's where I'd like to see the future going. I'd like to see the kids up and off in the world and finding their way, and us then being able to find a bit of time where we can just chill out a wee bit, you know, maybe work a wee bit less, and it probably won't happen, but but that's the plan. Who knows, you know, what the future holds for any of us, to be honest. But that's what I would like to see happening, you know. You know, terms are politically around like that, you know, it'll be what it's going to be, you know. There's obviously a big debate going on in the country at the moment about Scotland's future, and you know, and I'm all over the place with that, you know. Sometimes I'm in the yes camp, sometimes I'm in the no camp. Probably in the yes camp at the moment, and depending what happens with that, you know, I don't know whether we'll get dragged into something politically, you know, after that. But you know, I'm the type of person that always wants to take an interest in what's going on and about us, and I keep saying I want to pull back for it all. I've said even for the fan representation stuff and all that, I've been trying to sort of step back, but every time you get to the stage where you're stepping back, something happens and you're dragged back in it again. But I would like just to get back to the stage where I can just maybe nobody's involved and hope that there's other people come through and take up the mantle. And I always remember years ago going to the football when we used to all pack into the terracing any of the away games, and there was always a wee pocket of supporters in the main stand, we called at the time, we gave facility supporters, and inevitably were all older people, you know, quite often guys with shirts and ties, and but they all sat there and had their half and their beers, and I used to think, I can't wait, I'm older so I can be part of that, you know. And that's what I quite want to be now. I want to be one of the wee guys, it's just maybe a wee bit separate from the main throng, but still there as part of it, you know, and so maybe be able to take my feet off the gas a wee bit in that regard, you know, and just get back to sort of just having an ordinary sort of a take life as it comes sort of a existence, rather than at the moment we tend to react to almost everything, or, you know, and it does take a lot of time and it sucks a lot of your energy and stuff like that, and people don't realise it, and that's how I get upset sometimes, not just from my own point of view. You know, I see people like, you know, Jeanette, and not just Jeanette, other people get a kicking for some of the Celtic support, and it's quite vitriolic at times, and that saddens me, you know, that the Celtic support are so sort of a polarised at the moment, you know, and people can be attracted to Celtic for a whole load of different reasons, and we are a broad church, and I think that's all right, you know. In fact, it's one of the things that defines us, the fact that we're so inclusive. And but people should be allowed to have their thing without running the risk of getting slated for it, and you know, and so we should be allowed to bring, even as a wee political element to it, you know, and people don't like that, so what, you know. And so I would like us to get to the stage where the future would be that people just see that, you know, we are that broad church, and we should all be allowed to go to Celtic for whatever reason it is that draws us there, and that should be recognised and appreciated. But but it doesn't at the moment for some reason, and I don't know what the future holds, who knows, but I would like it to be a more tolerant, more understanding future where we can all sort of we can all live together. And
you were talking about Scotland earlier, Eddie. Could you give me one thing you would like to see changed in Scotland?
I have some concerns at the moment, and I see it quite often in my taxi about the level of intolerance, and I think it manifests itself in a whole load of different ways. I'm concerned about the amount of racism in Scotland at the moment, you know, and it's no in-your-face marching in the streets racism, but it's just wee things, and I can tell you the number of times I've stopped a taxi and put people out my taxi for them making racist comments, and you know, and they could be women in their 60s down to young guys, teenagers, and it's all about all these immigrants and all of that, and it's just the general talk about how, you know, people refer to, you know, members of other communities as, and I don't want to say the words, you know, in air here, but people know what they are, you know, the P words and the N words, and the, you know, the blacks this and the blacks that, and the Poles seem to get, everybody seems to get it, you know, and it's all, they're coming here and they're taking all our jobs and they're all getting big hooses in Bear's Den and they're all getting them fully furnished by the government. What a load of shite, you know. I mean, as somebody who worked in sort of a benefits in the welfare rights, I know. I mean, I could tell you horror stories about some of the things, you know, that these, you know, folk who come and, you know, try and find a bit of refuge in this country and what they've got to live with and put up with just to get the basics, you know. But there's a perception out there that doesn't happen, that they're, you know, they're met at the airport and chauffeur driven to a big fancy house and get all the comforts that, you know, the indigenous community have been denied. And what a load of rubbish, you know. And so I would like to see Scotland becoming much more tolerant and understanding as well. Again, I think, like amongst the Celtic support, I think in Scotland, even in the political debate, it's very intolerant and can very quickly get nasty and very polarised. It's either a nuzz or a dame sort of a thing. And I mean, how can it all be across the board? You know, we all go to share the country. And I mean, my granny used to say, may God rest her, my granny used to say, we all come into this world with nothing. and we'll all go out with nothing. So we really need to try our best to make the most of it while we're here. And I would like to think, I'd like to see a Scotland where we all made a conscious effort to do that, in order to understand any different people's needs and different people's cultures and backgrounds, and could live a shared future, if you like. You know, where, you know, Scotland's a great country. Glasgow's a great city. I love Glasgow. I love showing Glasgow off. But there are things that really disturb me about it, and one of the things is the level of racism. And, you know, there's been a couple of prominent cases in the papers and on the telly recently with that documentary in Sucky Ulstee where, you know, that really highlighted it for me. But, you know, and it was scary. But it wasn't a surprise to me, because I see it and hear it all the time. I mean, I picked a wee woman up in Duke Street, you know, a couple of weeks ago, and she came out to a local news agents and came out and says, oh, the so-and-sos in that shop, there's too many of them. And, you know, and I looked at her and said, what are you doing shopping in the shop, hen? You know, and she started again, you know, and they're taking their jobs and that. And I just pulled in. I says, listen, hen, I really don't want to listen to your racism. Would you mind just getting out and going and getting another taxi? She went nuts at me. You know, what do you mean? I'm no racist. I says, well, since you've gotten all you've did, a slag off a guy because he was an Asian. You know, the guy's providing you with a service that you're quite clearly happy to use. But you want to criticise a guy for it because he's coloured, or because but they don't belong here. And I said, well, the guy was probably born here, you know, and but she just didn't get it. And I think that permeates society at the moment, and it really concerns me. So I'd like to see that change. I think the multicultural nature of Scotland is fantastic. I think the new communities bring their own thing, their own colour, their own vibrancy, their own experiences, and whether it be their wine or their food or you know, their music, or, for me, that enhances Scotland, and there shouldn't be opposition. We should be welcoming, and that it makes us a much more balanced society. If we could change one thing about that in terms of talk, where it really, and again probably going back to the irritation thing, it really annoys the life out of me when I hear people from my community. I regard myself as an Irish Scot. I'm part of the Irish community, born in Scotland, effectively Scottish if you like, but part of the Irish community in Scotland, and I hate listening to people from my community talking about new immigrants in that style. And you see them, hold on a minute, you know, what did your granddad, your great-granddad have to put up with when he came? They were faced with the same abuse and intolerance. Nah, but we worked when we got here. Folk are coming to this country looking for work. They want to work. They've been denied opportunities, you know. We should be able to provide them refuge. We should be welcoming them and, you know, their skills and whatever. And I could go on all day. I mean, I'm going to tell you one story. When I worked in the Community Advice Centre, and it was at the time of the Gulf War conflict. I opened up one day and I met an Iraqi woman who was beside herself. And her man had been basically scooped up during the night. Chap at the door, in they came, lifted the man, took him away. Didn't tell him where. For no other reason, and he was an Iraqi national.
Right.
And he was lifted and taken away. And the woman didn't know where to go. She was beside herself. And she came to us, and through, again, my colleague Alison and myself, we were able to establish that the guy was eventually taken to Greenock Prison and then transferred to, I think it was Pentonville in London. And it was just because he was an Iraqi national. They were just scooping up all the Iraqi nationals. Now, this was a guy who came to the UK to study. He was studying to be a doctor, PhD educated guy, studying at Strathclyde Uni. But he came on a visa that meant he had no recourse to British funds. Basically, his maintenance and his fees and all that were all being paid by the Iraqi government, whatever the arrangement was. So he was living here and studying here, staying in a flat in Sight Hill. The woman was beside herself, left with three young kids. Absolutely nothing. Went to the Social Security. Can't help her. Took us a while to find out that the guy was in jail and where he was, and he wasn't getting released anytime soon. Eventually, through charitable donations and people helping out, we were able to get a woman some food. And we went to visit him and stuff like that a couple of times. And we got some money through the social work department at the time to sort of keep them going. But, and people would have said he should have just shouldn't have been in the country in the first place. This guy was coming here to make a difference. You know, this guy was coming here for an education. And yeah. And we'd probably have went back to his own country and used his skills to better people's lives and stuff like that. And I think it's great that, you know, our country should be able to give him that opportunity. Yeah, but people were saying, well, he shouldn't be here, and they should be saying to him, they're a threat to the Britain's safety. And this guy's family were completely opposed to the Iraqi regime at the time. And I think he had a brother killed, and this guy probably at this point couldn't have went to him because of his family's activities in Iraq. And he was in jail for quite some time during that conflict. It was eventually released, but again on the proviso that the British state couldn't look after him, but he couldn't get him. He was working in hotels washing dishes. That's what he was doing, you know, to provide for his family and stuff. Anyway, eventually all the bureaucracy and all that was settled, and he was getting some help for his estate and stuff like that, and went on with his life, and he invited us up to his house one night for a dinner, you know, and we went up and we had a great time, you know, and they really looked after us and, you know, overfed us. But it was one of the things, you were, couldn't have ate the amount of food they were putting down there, but you felt you were, might have been disrespectful, so you were shoving grub in. And we had a great night, but some of the stories that that guy could tell us about what happened to him really hit home for me about the level of intolerance there is in this country. And this was a guy, as I say, who was trying to better, he made a difference in the world. Mm-hmm. Guy was quite clearly with skills, was forced to wash dishes to keep feed his family. He was jailed for nothing other than being, you know, a native of a country that we decided to go and invade because of the oil and, you know, all that sort of stuff. So, but for me, it shows the sort of a level of intolerance. So I'd like to develop a better understanding of the different sort of cultures and diversity of the world and make it a better place for us all.
Right, if you had a choice from history to have a beer and a wee chat with somebody, who would it be?
Really, really difficult question. There's been loads of historical figures that you would love to sit down and say, you know, what made you do that and what made you do that? And I know everybody says Mandela, and I would love to have had Mandela as a dinner guest. What a guy, you know. I still can remember, you know, where I was the day. It was one of the moments, you know, the Mandela moment when he came out of jail and stuff like that. And I'd love to have met Wolf Tone, you know, in terms of, you know, where he was at that time, you know, pushing for Ireland and their identity. And probably because of the recent history, would be Mandela. But if there's one person I could bring back in the world to have a beer and a halfway, it would be my old man. my dad died young, and again, as I say, I've got lots of political influences and lots of heroes for the past that I would like to have asked them this, that, or the next thing. But if I really, really wanted to personalise it and say, is there somebody you could bring back here for a day and go out for a beer with and ask them all the things, it'd be my old man.
Excellent answer, Eddie. Right, your favourite cartoon character?
Again, I'm thinking about this. And I wasn't going to say the. And in fact, Jeanette, when she did the Desert Island Times, probably stole my favourite character, because I think she says Calamero. And mine would have been Calamero as well, because he was a wee guy who always proclaimed that everything was an injustice. And we probably think the same, myself and Jeanette, in that regard. So I used to love Calamero, but quite cruel Calamero for me as well when I was away, because people, for some reason, I've always had a big bald head. Some people describe it as a head like a 30 bald cabbage. But when I was young, some other folk used to say that my head was like sort of an egg shaped head. So people used to call me, those cruel guys in Easter, it's just a Calamero there, you know. So I love Wiley Coyote,
right,
for the Roadrunner, just for his sheer persistence and for taking everything that was thrown at him and just getting up and just getting on with it, you know, sort of a thing, you know. He did what he could, you know, he stopped the Roadrunner, but, you know, things inevitably blew up in his face. And he's one of these guys that always set out with a specific target and it always went wrong, you know. But he just went, moved on, you know, from plan A to plan B to plan C. And so I think for his persistence and his sheer doggedness and refusal to give up, I think probably Wiley E. Coyote.
Right, your penultimate song.
My penultimate song, and again, it's probably getting a wee bit more political now, and I think it's quite an appropriate song given the time it is as well. You know, Bobby Sands, we're sitting here on the Monday, Bobby Sands would have been 60 years of age yesterday, you know. When you think back and you think, wow, he would have been 60, you know, I'm 51. It's a guy who was only 9 years older than me, and sometimes tend not to think about his age. It's sort of almost ageless because of the story. But the hunger strike for me was just, you know, an incredible time, and it summed up a lot about human courage and resilience and, you know, just sheer determination to know that what you were doing was right. And again, you talk about guys you'd like to have met for earlier, you know, I'd love to have known what was in Bobby Sands' head when he agreed to embark on that second hunger strike, knowing everybody knew that that was going to be a, you know, a strike to the end. Mm-hmm. People probably didn't accept that they were going to allow 10 guys to sacrifice their lives. But I think there was probably an acceptance when Bobby Sands set out that for him, being the, you know, the first one on that strike,
yeah,
I think there was only going to be, you know, one conclusion. Mm-hmm. And he probably knew that more than anybody, but decided to sort of embark on the strike anyway and lead that strike. And wow, what a decision, you know. And But it was much more to Bobby Sands that we don't get to hear about in this country, obviously because, you know, British censorship in the country we live in. But Bobby Sands was just an incredible man. He seen himself ultimately, you know, as a soldier. But had he not been dragged into that conflict, like a lot of young men in Ireland at the time, you know, the opportunities for a guy with his talents were incredible. You know, when you read some of his writings and his poetry, and he produced songs like, you know, like Macklehattan, like Song for Marcella, like Back Home in Derry, and, you know, just fantastic songs, you know. It made you think more about what that guy was as a human being and the talents he had. It disgusts me now that, you know, people in this country are criminalising people for remembering that and singing about that, and it's just, it breaks your heart. You know, it really does break your heart that you have so-called nationalist Republican politicians in this country criminalising people for keeping the memory of Sands and people like that alive. You know, I mentioned three songs there and I could have picked any of the three of them. But I think, you know, just a time to reflect, you know, Bobby Sands' 60th birthday and a time to reflect on that whole period and the sacrifices that people did. I'm going to choose probably the most well-known one, but just to commemorate that period, it would be the song would be Back Home in Derry, sung by Christy Moore. Just sums up the talent of the man, I think.
Right, we've come to the part of the programme where I give you the complete works of the Dandy and a copy of the Bible to take with you to your island. Would you like a copy of the Bible?
I would take a copy of the Bible. I mean, I'm very much a practicing Catholic. My faith's really important to me. I'm a Christian, but I see myself as a, you know, a practicing Catholic, and it's something that really influences me in a lot of things I do. So I suppose where we hear the Bible as Catholics is by we going to Mass every week and listening to, you know, the readings and the Gospels and stuff like that. And, you know, and that's a thing, you know, it's been very influential throughout my life, you know, and I think if we can all live our life according to the, you know, and I don't want to be, you know, sort of a tub-thumping preacher here at NLA, but I think if we can all live our lives, you know, around the sort of teachings of Jesus and listening to what, you know, what was says in the Bible, then we'll not go far wrong in the world. And I don't necessarily, you know, I know people can have their own interpretations of that, and the churches that sometimes as well, we need to remember are all human institutions and have their own sort of a, you know, as all humans do, we all have our own failings and we all make mistakes, but I think my faith underpins what I am as a human being, and, you know, and it's something that I'll always have, and it's something that I've always encouraged my kids to have, and so I would need to take the Bible.
Which other book would you take?
Again, I've thought about this question, there are a number of books. I'm not a great one for going back and reading books again and again. I like to read historical books, but particularly historical books from people who were there as part of that history. So I like reading a lot of political biographies and stuff like that. And again, I don't want to keep going on about the Irish conflict, but that particular, you know, period in, you know, the war in Ireland. But I love reading stories for folk who were actually involved in, you know, the war from 69 onwards, and you know, guys who maybe had been in prison, and, you know, and how it affected their communities and stuff like that. And I read Lawrence McKeown's book where he did his PhD in about his time in Loncash, and I found that really moving. I've just recently finished Jerry Kelly's book, The Escape, which talks about the Great Escape for Loncash, and it's, when you talk about the Great Escape, it should really be made into a film. It's quite a humorous wee book, but again, it underlined for me the sacrifices and what these people did, but also about the talent of the individuals. You know, a whole generation of people who were drawn into a conflict and looked up, and you know, the amount of talent that these people had was just incredible. And so, books like that always influenced me. Politically, I used to love reading books like, you know, people like Tony Benn. I loved reading his stuff. I think everybody should read The Ragged Trousered Philanthropist at least once, for in terms of sort of a defining people's politics. I think every teenager should be made to read that. Catcher in Their Eyes, another book I think that every teenager should be made to read before they leave school. But there's one book that I've always meant to read again that I read about 30 years ago, and I've never ever got around to doing it. And only thinking about this question, I'm actually going to now make a point of doing it quite soon. And it was Catch 22. You know, if there's any book that sums up the absurdity of war in the military and all of that sort of stuff, and how the big guy gets to shit in the wee guy, you know, all the time. I think it's that book. So for that reason, what I should probably take is The Idiot's Guide to Surviving in a Desert Island, because I'm not very good at, you know, with my hands and at building things, and as anybody that knows me. But I think I would like to take Catch 22 and read that book again. And again, I think it's a book that if any kid out there ever speaks to their parents and saying they're thinking about joining the army or looking at military life, the parents should immediately tell them to go and read a copy of Catch 22, because I'm sure that'll dissuade them. So I think it would be Catch 22. It's a great book.
Good choice. Right, a luxury. Something to make your life on island a bit more bearable. And remember, it can't be a human being and it can't be a mobile phone.
Okay, so these are impossible questions. I'm not sure how long I'm going to be in this island. If I thought I was going to get rescued relatively quickly, something that would make my life in island sort of a pass a bit more pleasurably would probably be a nice case of Buna Harbin or a nice 18-year-old malt whiskey or something like that. So I wouldn't mind that, but I'm not sure. For some people, that might not be deemed as a luxury. It probably would for me. I quite like the idea of, you know, after my days foraging and trying to build shelter and find source of heat and stuff like that, to be able to pour myself out a nice malt whiskey at the end of that, I think it'd be good. So I'm not sure how much I would need to take in terms of quantity, but I'll not be greedy and I'll say maybe a nice case of malt.
Right, Eddie, your final song.
My final song is a song that, again, it just reflects sort of a finality about a lot of things for me. I hate going to nights out. Again, I always seem to be irritating. things that irritate me at the moment are, see the song Loch Lomond, the Run Rig song.
Aye.
You know when you go to parties and stuff like that, and at the end of the night, the DJ always feels compelled to stick that song on, and everybody all gets up into a big huddle and jumps about mad. That song annoys the life out of me. I really don't know why. It's probably a good song, and Run Rig are a decent band, but for some reason, that song annoys, and I hate when that, you know, that big crescendo at the start, and I almost feel like leaving the party at that point. So that annoys me, that particular song, and I think this song I'm talking about would be a much more appropriate song for finishing a good family gathering. I think we should finish most parties. I had my 50th last year in St Paul's Hall in Shelton, and I finished with two songs. One was You'll Never Walk Alone. I always, see if you're going to have a big huddle at the end of a party, we don't need to be Run Rig. Mm-hmm. Get Jerry and the Pacemakers on and have a big huddle to You'll Never Walk Alone. It's much more appropriate for us. Again, I think you go up and ask some DJs that and they're like, oh, I don't know if we can play that. Who are we going to upset? Yeah. Well, it's my party. I don't care who I'm upsetting, you know. So get You'll Never Walk Alone on. Don't use any of your Run Rig. So I was going to pick You'll Never Walk Alone for that reason. But this wee song is a song that, you know, see if I've been to a night out, or myself or Jeanette have been out, and we like to get home and put on different songs, and we can listen to almost anything. It could be Ruth's T. Wainwright, it could be Ray Charles, it could be... We inevitably finish up with the Pogues.
Right.
And a wee song we love, having a wee dance in the living room with me after a good night out, and I love finishing a night halfway, is this particular song. I just think it's a great wee song, and it's Rainy Night in Soho. My favourite Pogue song.
Eddie Toner, thank you very much for being a Desert Island Tim.
It's been a pleasure, Billy. I found it very cathartic. Cheers.
Fantastic.